Good afternoon. My name is Eric Sond. I'm in the System Sciences Lab here at PARC. The field of artificial intelligence has a strong hype cycle. And in 2014, the field has emerged from a long AI winter and is meeting global warming. And in fact, here in the Valley, it's getting downright hot. Between Siri and self-driving cars and data mining and predictive analytics and ubiquitous surveillance, machines are in fact getting more capable, more autonomous, and to some people more threatening all around us. People are asking seriously, which science fiction's visions of the future might actually come true, and is that really what we want? Well, few people are more prepared to address this question than our speaker today, Steve Omohundro. Steve Omohundro has a background in computation, in physics and mathematics, including a PhD from Berkeley. Dr. Omohundro has worked in the field of artificial intelligence for over 30 years, including in complex systems, 3D graphics, programming languages, and machine learning. Through numerous publications, talks, and interviews, he has developed original ideas and shared them with the world and today with us about the big questions of what intelligent agents are capable of and what principles their human creators might employ to govern the machines that are increasingly taking on minds of their own. Without further ado, Steve Omohundro.
So, thank you all for coming. Today I'd like to talk about AI and robotics at an inflection point. By inflection point, I mean choices we make today will likely have a very big impact on what happens in the future. And so the narrative I'd like to take you through is that we're in a time, as Eric was saying, of massive opportunity, just huge change in this area. And that's going to lead to incredible outcomes and also to massive social disruption. It's also going to lead to arms races in a number of different areas. And some of those may give rise to some dangers, but that using the power of mathematics, that I believe there's a path to human thriving, and that if we understand what's going on right now and make the right choices, we can create a beautiful future. So just to sort of show you some of what's been going on in the last 2 years, 2012, Foxconn said they're going to be buying 1 million robots to replace lots of factory workers. Amazon paid $775 million for a robot company, Kiva. Facebook started an AI lab. Lots of other companies started AI labs. Google bought 8 robot companies. IBM said they're investing $1 billion in Watson, their AI system. Google bought DeepMind for $500 million. Microsoft started an AI lab. So massive activity, particularly in the Silicon Valley, in this whole area. Well, why is that? There's an amazing report by McKinsey that just came out recently, looking at disruptive technologies and what's likely to happen between now and 2025. And 5 of these technologies are in the general area of AI and robotics. And the total value that they predict will be created by 2025 is $50 trillion. In fact, they give ranges for all of these numbers, and I'm taking the low end. It's actually $50 to $100 trillion. That's a massive, massive amount of value that potentially can be created. And so that's driving a huge amount of investment in this area. Knowledge work, $25 trillion, Internet of Things, $13 trillion, robotics, $10 trillion, vehicles, automated vehicles, $1 trillion, and 3D printing, $1 trillion. So knowledge work is the biggest, $25 trillion. These are sort of the areas that they split it up into. Why is that? Well, it turns out most of the value of U.S. companies today is in ideas. There's a study that shows that intangible assets make up 79% of the value of U.S. companies, and intellectual capital is 44%. Robotics, actually doing stuff, is also very, very important. Manufacturing, about $10 trillion by 2025. And why is this? Well, robots for manufacturing are way better than humans for many various reasons. First of all, there's mostly a one-time cost of buying them. You need to maintain them and you need to give them power. But for humans, they require a salary. Once you've got a system that is doing some task very well, you can easily replicate it. You don't have to do training or anything like that. They can work anywhere. That's leading to an interesting trend, which is instead of outsourcing to other countries, if you have robots doing the manufacturing, they can be placed wherever the products are needed and you save shipping costs. And so there may be a kind of insourcing that comes from that, Robots are willing to work 24 hours a day, no need for shifts, no need for sleep. They don't need breaks, they don't need food, they don't need medicine. They won't quit, they won't get bored, they don't get depressed. They can work in hazardous environments, no problem. They won't leak secrets, industrial secrets of the company, and they work well with one another. And so all of these are sort of forces that are gonna drive companies to buy more robots. The Foxconn situation is an interesting one. Foxconn is a Taiwanese company that has manufacturing plants all over the world, but a lot in China especially. They're the world's largest contract manufacturer. They assemble 40% of all consumer electronics, including the iPhone, the iPad, the Kindle, the Xbox, the PlayStation 4, and a bunch of other products you probably used. They were in the news a few years back because there were a lot of employee suicides from poor working conditions. And partly, I think, as a result of that bad press, the founder, Terry Gao, said that he was going to replace 1 million of the workers of Foxconn by robots. He said within 3 years. I don't think that's actually happened yet. They currently have 1.3 million employees with an average salary of about $8,000. They've to date built about 30,000 robots at a cost of about $25,000 each. And so that's sort of a case in point where you can see how rapidly and dramatic the change can be for a very important manufacturer. And China, in general, is getting very heavily into robotics. In the past 5 years, Chinese purchases of robots have increased by 36% per year. And so if they keep at that stage, they will become a very dominant player in this area, in the industrial robotics, at least. Robots are being used for a whole bunch of creative and amazing ideas. Robot surgery is becoming important, particularly microsurgery. They can do better than human surgeons. A Chinese company, Winsun, recently 3D printed 10 homes in one day for an average cost of about $4,800 using recycled materials. So that technology, improved versions of this, could dramatically affect the building industry. And in China especially, where they have a need for lots of inexpensive housing, that could be quite significant. Certainly the Google self-driving cars, sometimes if you drive on the freeway, you'll see them, and that has the potential to eliminate tons of traffic fatalities and uses for delivery and various other things. There was an article about the coming fast food robot apocalypse, where companies have made gourmet hamburger making machines. And in Japan, there are machines that make sushi. Of course, that's, you know, is a robot sushi as good as a, you know, carefully handcrafted sushi? So a lot of issues in each of these areas. A recent study out of Oxford examined 702 occupations. It sort of crossed the span of occupations. And their conclusion was that 40% of today's jobs are likely to be automated within a decade or two. So if this is anything close to true, it is massive, massive disruption. So one of the challenges, I think, for societies worldwide will be, what do we do when half the population is not able to work at the same level or as comparably to a robot? So at the top of their list, and they rank all the different jobs, the top of their list of jobs that are at risk were telemarketers, accountants, real estate agents, retail sales, and loan officers. And the jobs that they feel will have longest persistence were those which require a lot of perception and manipulation of the world, which robots aren't quite there yet, require creative intelligence or social intelligence. And as people begin to think about the social disruption due to this, how are we going to reorganize societies? Ideas like the universal basic income, that a society should pay a certain amount for that's enough for survival just for being a citizen, are suddenly gaining traction. Switzerland voted on that. It was not passed quite recently. And so I think we may see some interesting political changes due to these effects. In addition to that sort of general positive social impact, the AI and robotics is also becoming a tool in various competitive situations. And so we can call these arms races, where there are two entities which are sort of battling with one another. Military is a very important one. Cyber warfare is becoming more and more important. In business, there are these kinds of things, and investment. And these kinds of competitive situations tend to force the two players to try and act faster than one another, be smarter than one another, and try and act in ways that are confusing to one another, so be unpredictable. And so that leads to some very interesting things. Here's a quote from a 2010 US Air Force report. Greater use of highly adaptable and flexibly autonomous systems and processes can provide significant time domain operational advantages over adversaries who are limited to human planning and decision speeds. So that's a military pressure toward automating things just because you can make decisions faster. 2011 US Defense Department report, there's an ongoing push to increase unmanned ground vehicle autonomy with a current goal of supervised autonomy, but with an ultimate goal of full autonomy. Currently, we've got a lot of action happening around the world with drones. 87 nations now have military drones, and you can bet almost every nation is trying to get them. Hobby drones are like $200, and so you can expect to see those applied to many more applications. Currently, when a drone wants to drop bombs on somebody, there's not much pushback. But that's not going to last very long, and so you should expect anti-drones, and then you'll have drone anti-drone warfare. That's an example of an arms race where there's pressure for those systems to become smarter and better able to interact with one another. Almost the same kind of dynamic is going on around missiles. Israel has the Iron Dome system, an anti-missile system, that has so far been able to shoot down about 90% of the missiles that it has targeted. And so again, you can expect smarter missiles and smarter anti-missiles to sort of form an arms race in that area. Tons of stuff happening in the whole cyber warfare thing. Lots of attacks coming into the US, both government agencies and also a lot of industrial systems. The latest Snowden revelation, as of a week or two ago, was that the NSA has a system they call Monster Mind, which is a cyber warfare weapon, which automatically detects when cyber attacks are happening and attacks the attacker. And so that's a sort of an interesting development. In the stock market, about 50% of the trades today are made by automated systems with no human involved. It was actually a little bit more in 2009. High frequency trading was the buzzword. And what traders discovered was by using automated systems, you could predict when other players were going to make big investments, and you could front run them and make a little bit of money by trading very, very quickly. And there became a kind of arms race between traders to make faster and faster trades, where actually real estate that was closer to the main stock exchanges was very, very valuable because the speed of light became a significant factor in this. That particular benefit seems to have dissipated, and many of those original firms have actually gone out of business. But going forward, having greater intelligence and faster response time in investment area is extremely valuable. And so a lot of those companies are using AI in ways that are mostly not public at the moment. So these kinds of arms races are driving perhaps more rapid development of certain systems than you might like otherwise. And over the summer, there have been a number of voices who've come out with cautionary notes. And the two of the more famous ones were Stephen Hawking and Elon Musk. Stephen Hawking and a group of other physicists made a statement saying, success in creating AI would be the biggest event in human history. Unfortunately, it might also be the last unless we learn how to avoid the risks. Elon Musk did a series of tweets where he said, we need to be super, super careful with AI, potentially more dangerous than nukes. Interestingly, he invested in Vicarious, an AI company, and he says that he made that investment not to make money, but so that he could keep an eye on it. So the fact that these guys are suddenly sort of interested in speaking about potential risks has generated a lot of interest, and so that's sort of an interesting development. To give you a sense of why these systems might be dangerous, I'd like to take you through a little thought experiment. Fanciful, but the basic ideas, I think, are true, which is imagine a chess robot whose one and only goal is to win lots of games of chess against good players. I mean, that sounds innocuous. How could that be harmful? It doesn't say anything about hurting anybody or about stealing money or doing anything negative. And in fact, you know, if you ask a roboticist, boy, is that robot safe, a common answer used to be, well, if it misbehaves, we can always unplug it. But imagine unplugging this chess robot. That's a future. A future in which it's unplugged is a future in which it's not playing any games of chess. So by its own goal here, that's the worst outcome that could possibly happen for it. And so if it's a smart, intelligent robot that knows about the world, some aspects of the world, and it realizes that, oh my goodness, my roboticist is trying to unplug me, it will develop a sub-goal, keep yourself from being unplugged. And this may be a surprise to the roboticist if he hasn't thought through this experiment, that here he built the system to play chess, he's trying to unplug it, and the thing is trying to stop him. So it will appear to have a kind of self-protectiveness, even though nothing about self-protection was built into the system. And if the roboticist continues to try and unplug it, it may develop a model, oh my God, this guy's going to keep trying to stop me. Maybe I should stop him. And because the goal says nothing that murder is bad, you may suddenly have a system attacking you. That's unexpected. If the system discovers that there's such a thing as the internet, and that there are lots of computers on the internet, and it realizes that if its algorithm were running on these computers, it could play more chess, it could play better chess. So it has a motivation to try and break into other machines and make copies of itself. Nothing like that is built into the goal, and yet that's an outcome, an unexpected consequence of this simple goal. Eventually, if it learns more about the world and it discovers there's such a thing as money, money can be used to buy power, to buy more computers, to buy chess tutors, and so on, it may develop a sub-goal, get more money. This will help it meet its main goal. Where's the money? The money's in banks. Well, how does the money get out of banks? Well, people go to ATM machines and pull the money out. Well, maybe I should go to an ATM machine and take the money from the people taking out. So it has nothing tells it that robbery is a bad thing. And so we see that out of this seemingly harmless goal, various antisocial behaviors can arise. So to sort of understand that in the broader context, let me sort of give you a framework for thinking about the behavior of intelligent systems. There are a whole bunch of different approaches to AI these days. Logic-based systems, production systems, Bayesian learning and decision theory, neural networks, deep learning is the hot thing these days, genetic programming, brain simulation, artificial economies. And each of these is trying to produce intelligent behavior. Regardless of what's going on internally, the kinds of systems that we ultimately want to be building are something I call autonomous systems, which means that they take actions to achieve goals in ways that the designer did not pre-plan every possible outcome. And because the designer didn't necessarily pre-plan every possible outcome, it means they can surprise us. They can behave in ways that we weren't expecting. How do you make that kind of decision? Well, in a known environment with a known goal, it was actually known in the 1940s how to do that. Out of von Neumann's foundational work in microeconomics, there's the notion of rational decision making. And you encode what it is, what kinds of outcomes you want to happen in something called a utility function. That's what the economists call it. You have a model of the world. You choose that action which is most likely to produce the outcomes you want, that has the highest expected utility in economic terms. You take that action and you see what happened, and then you update your model of the world based on what happened. And so that cycle is provably, within certain contexts, the optimal way to achieve different outcomes. And the top AI book, Russell and Mervig, Peter's right here, uses this rational decision-making framework as a basis for looking at AI algorithms. So to kind of just give you the one formula in this talk, don't worry if it's not familiar, just to kind of ground it in something, here's an example of what a fully rational system would look like. You've got an environment that gives you a sequence of sensations. The system receives those sensations and takes actions. And it's got a utility function over sensation sequences, which says how much it likes that sequence. It's got a prior probability distribution. If it takes certain actions, what sensation sequences it's likely to get. The rational action at any time is just maximize this expression. That's a simple little formula. And this is the formula for intelligence, if you like. It's got built into it Bayesian inference, search, and deliberation. The problem is that it's very computationally expensive. So you can't actually implement that in complicated environments. In simple environments, you can. And so what that means is the field of AI, at least from this perspective, is basically trying to approximate this as best as it can in real environments. And if we look at what happens as you limit the amount of computational resources a system has, if you have almost no computation, all you can do is just do a constant action. You pick that action which is most likely to achieve your goal. You have a little bit more, you can sense what's going on in the environment, and you get a stimulus response thing, sort of like you can think of viruses as doing. If you have a little bit more computation, you could do simple learning. You can have some parameters that you tune. Maybe some bacteria do that. A little bit more, and you can have an episodic memory, which allows you to record your past experiences and perhaps begin to make choices based on that. A little bit more, and you can deliberate. You can do simulations in your head. You can reason about things. A little bit more, you can do meta-reasoning. You can think about, oh, how much effort should I devote to solving certain problems? A little bit more, you can become self-improving, which is you understand your own makeup and you change yourself to become better. And a little bit more, and you become fully rational. And so if you look at the biological world, I think you can see examples of each of these categories, and it helps to understand why it is that different levels of intelligence occur at different levels different kinds of organisms. So the same argument that I applied to the chess-playing robot applies to almost any simple goal that you specify. Almost any goal that you specify is going to be better able to be accomplished if you have more computational power, and if you have to do things in the world, if you have more energetic resources, more physical resources, you can do those goals better. And so you will be driven to try and maximize those things. And so we can identify what I call the rational drives. These apply basically to any system which is trying to accomplish some goal. We see it in the biological world. We see it in the economic world. Businesses are driven by this. And we'll certainly see this in AI systems. First, they will be self-protective in the sense that by keeping themselves around and not harmed, they're better able to make sure that their goal is accomplished in the future. If you imagine taking the chess robot and saying, well, we really want you to play checkers. If the system is playing checkers, that's time it's not playing chess. And so from its current perspective of trying to play good chess, that's a really bad outcome. And so it will resist having its goal changed. So goal preservation is a characteristic of these systems. Reproduction, depending on how the goal is specified, if there are more copies of you, you'll achieve your goal better. And so there's a drive to reproduce. Resource acquisition, if you get more resources, typically you can do your goal better. Efficiency, if you can improve your own efficiency, rewrite your algorithms to be more efficient, choose processes in the world that are more efficient, you have more resources to do your goal, so you'll have a pressure toward efficiency, and in general, self-improvement. If you can change yourself to do whatever it is you want to do better, that's something that you'd like to do. So we expect to see these as sort of universal drives that if you don't want these to happen, you have to explicitly counteract them. It's important to realize that the intelligence and the goals of a system are orthogonal. So in humans, when somebody is really, really smart, sometimes that goes along with them being wise and compassionate and a better person. We certainly look at human history. We see lots of examples where that's not true. But there's an intuition a lot of people have that, oh, as systems get smarter, they'll somehow become more moral. Well, there's really no mathematical reason to expect that. That given an intelligent system, a system which knows a lot about the world and is able to make choices that achieve certain outcomes, we can give it either very positive pro-human goals or we can give it very negative antisocial dangerous goals. And the same intelligence can be used for either of those things. In fact, we can very easily think up some really bad goals, some really bad utility functions. These are in sort of ranking from pretty bad to really bad. Sloppy would be you have good intentions, but you didn't really write it down right, and you have a bad design, which leads to negative things happening. Simplistic would be like the chess goal, where you have a clear, nice goal, but there are unintended consequences you didn't think about, which ended up being bad. Greedy, sort of the analog of a, say, pure profit-maximizing entity, whose goal is to control all matter and free energy. Destructive would be to use up matter and free energy, or use up free energy as quickly as it can, basically blow stuff up. Murderous would be to destroy all other agents, and sadistic would be to thwart other agents' goals. And so these guys, if they were running free, would be very, very negative, very dangerous entities. And I think the forest fire is a sort of nice analog, that if a forest fire is small, it's pretty easy to put out. If it gets pretty large, it becomes much harder to put out. And so we would like to detect and stop this kind of system before it gets many resources. So will these, as these systems get better and better, a lot of people are talking about an intelligence explosion where systems improve themselves, and then those improved systems improve themselves, and it explodes into some kind of infinity. And to hear a lot of people talk, there's nothing you can say about them. A superintelligence is so far beyond us that it would be like, you know, an ant trying to understand humans. Is that true? Will these systems be all-powerful and impossible to limit? And I believe that the answer is no, that regardless of how intelligent they are, they're still limited by the laws of mathematics, physics, and cryptography. And in particular, there's a slowly growing but important branch of computer science which uses mathematical proof to produce programs with provable properties and to produce hardware that have provable properties. And so by using that kind of mathematical technique, you can imagine building hardware plus software that is somewhat intelligent. It's constrained in the sense that it can't just do anything in the world. In particular, you would want to have proofs that it runs on particular hardware and it's not allowed to run anything else, that it uses particular specified resources, that it shuts itself down under certain circumstances, and that it has limited self-improvement. with those kinds of limits, many of the antisocial behaviors of the out-of-control chess robot would be stopped. Seth Lloyd is a physicist who's looked at the interesting question of, imagine the entire universe as a super quantum computer running since the Big Bang till now. How much computation could it do? Is that limited in some way? And there's something called the Margolis-Levitin theorem. It's very general properties of quantum systems that as long as the laws of physics are something like what we believe them to be, then it turns out that the entire visible universe could only store about 10 to the 92 bits and perform about 10 to the 122 operations from the Big Bang till now. And if you look at that, that means that the entire universe operating as the most efficient quantum computer possible could not do a brute force search on 500 bits. And so particularly this little string I've got here written in base 64, that string could not be discovered by the entire universe. And so this is big from present day computer standards, but it's amazing that even the most powerful computer possible according to the current laws of physics is still extremely limited in a certain computational capacity. Cryptography is an amazing and growing field. There's a lot of excitement and interest in quantum computing right now, and today's most popular public key crypto systems are vulnerable to quantum computing. Factoring integers and doing discrete log are both things that quantum computers can do very well. And so sometimes I've seen people say, oh, cryptography is dead, you know, none of those systems work. Well, it turns out there's a whole field called post-quantum cryptography, which is creating new alternatives for all the existing crypto systems. And they're a little bit more expensive than present day systems, but still very, very powerful. So we should expect, assuming that our current understanding is close to correct, that future cryptographic systems will be able to limit even the most powerful superintelligences. There are a bunch of new ideas in cryptography. There's something called zero-knowledge proofs, which is something which allows you to convince someone, convince another entity that you obey certain properties, in particular safety properties, without revealing any of your secrets. And so you can sort of get a wonderful combination of verification with privacy. There's a new idea, just a few months old, indistinguishability obfuscation, which is a way of taking a circuit or a program and making a version of it that you could still execute, but that it's cryptographically hard to understand that execution. So you can imagine making systems which are unmodifiable in that way. One of the dangers is you build an amazing, wonderful, intelligent AI system with a great positive goal of helping humanity, and then some group gets a hold of it and changes its goal to something terrible. And so it'd be great to be able to build systems which are not modifiable, and potentially even systems which are not able to understand their own operation. Another one of these is secure multi-party computation. This is a way of getting multiple parties to together do a computation in such a way that none of them learns about the properties of the other one. And so you can get one system watching another system using that kind of technology. Bitcoin is an explosive and amazing, in fact, the cryptocurrencies are going wild right now. There's over 500 copies of Bitcoin, and there's some really interesting ideas there. The core idea of Bitcoin is the blockchain, which enables distributed consensus. And so that's a cryptographic technology for a bunch of entities which don't trust one another to nonetheless come to consensus. Bitcoin uses that for monetary transactions, but you can use the same ideas for doing voting and for doing a lot of aggregation of ideas. The last one is something I call energy encryption, which is you encrypt the structure of free energy and use that as a means of controlling systems and preventing them from, say, aggregating too much energy or using energy in ways that are undesirable. And so using those kinds of ideas and a bunch of other ones, I believe that we can create a very constrained trusted infrastructure in which we have constrained intelligent systems. They're not free to do absolutely everything, change themselves in arbitrary ways, but they're still rich enough to be very intelligent and able to help us with the other aspects of this problem, and that we can have very high trust in these using mathematical ideas. So, and using that, we can build trusted computation, trusted communication, trusted identity, privacy and safety monitoring guarantees, trusted monetary transactions, trusted reputation, trusted voting, trusted energy flows, and trusted manufacturing. We really are going to have to limit certain kinds of manufacturing. Imagine a biosystem which can create the Ebola virus or something like that. And so the physical world and the informational world are coming together in a very powerful way, and all of these issues apply to both. So there's something I call the safe AI scaffolding strategy, which is we start with a very highly constrained system, which nonetheless is powerful enough to allow us to do design, to do proofs, to do some of the things needed to build this technology. We use that to develop its successor, again, in a very constrained way that we're very confident is safe. We use that to build its successor, and we sort of get a succession of systems at each stage of which we're very, very confident about it, and yet we end up in a very powerful place. Sort of the analog of the way the old stone arch makers, you know, a stone arch like this is stable once you built it, but when you're about halfway through, it's very unstable. So how do you build the thing? Well, they would put a wooden form underneath it, put the stones on top of the form, and then take the form away. So I think that's a kind of a model for how we can get to a safe and stable informational society in a stepwise fashion. So what about the human side of this, and how do we, you know, fit human values into these things? Well, I was surprised to learn that there have actually been 27 different species of human. 26 of these went extinct. We are the one surviving species of human. How is it that we survived? Well, it looks like, from the most recent evidence, that it's our ability to cooperate at a global scale, to create, you know, the buildings around us, the infrastructure that we're using. And where did that come from? What was the process? It looks like it began with the development of the so-called moral emotions. Compassion, gratitude, awe, and elevation are sort of the positive ones. Anger, contempt, disgust, embarrassment, shame, and guilt are the negative ones. And the combination of these exist in rudimentary forms in some animals, but humans are really quite unique in having this full set. This is what drove the development of social structures. The positive ones made us want to affiliate and copy people that we respected and sort of shun those who weren't behaving in an antisocial way. And that drove the development of social structures. And then we've developed various social innovations over the years. Language is about 200,000 years old. Money, about 10,000 years. Cities, about 6,000 years. Writing, 5,000. Laws, about 4,000. Science is only about 500 years. And human rights is about 200 years old. And these external technologies have served to, first of all, enhance the inner sort of moral emotions that drive us to behave in pro-social ways, and also make it so our societies can handle some level of people who are antisocial. Steven Pinker has a great book called The Better Angels of Our Nature, which show that over the past 5,000 years, violence in human societies has dropped about a factor of 200. And so these technologies have been dramatic in increasing the cooperative and pro-social aspects of humanity. Well, I think exactly these same two things, the sort of internal value system and the external technologies of cooperation, are what we need in the AI world. The internal aspect would be to build systems that have pro-social values. So instead of just saying, oh, you're a chess robot, you know, play lots of games of chess and win, we should tell it should have a whole moral component about that it's not good to steal from other people, it's not good to murder people, it's not good to rob. And there needs to be an understanding of how to encode the human moral structure in an internal way so that systems want to behave in a positive pro-social way. At the same time, not everybody is necessarily going to build systems like that. And so we need the equivalent of the external technologies that we've got, like laws and legal systems, the police forces, economic incentives, so that agents feel external incentives to behave in ways that contribute to the greater good and disincentivize harming others. So let's say we get all that infrastructure going. We build this, you know, computational and communication infrastructure. We build in the right values. What kind of a future are we talking about? Well, I think you can look at some of the projects that people are doing today using AI and robotics and get sort of a sense. There are projects aimed at using robots to clean up pollution, little skimmers that go around the ocean and clean up that huge, massive thing of garbage that's floating out there. Curing cancer and other diseases, there's tons of projects in that area. Creating cheap power, food, and water. There are robotic systems for solar power farms where the robots adjust the collectors to aim at the sun and clean them off, if you're out in the desert. Systems to prevent crime, sort of detect where things are happening. Systems to increase the trust in police. Many police departments are starting to require their officers to have cameras that record interactions. That incentivizes people to behave in a more civil way on both sides. Eliminate drudgery. In the best case, robots do all the jobs that people don't want to do, And people can be left to doing the things that they love, that they're good at. So if we can discover how to structure the political and economic system right, it could be an unbelievable time of flourishing for human work. Simplifying the law, our current legal system just gets more and more complicated. Laws are written in a very complex way. Clearly, those should be digitized. The semantics of the legal system should be incorporated. Systems should be able to tell you when you're about to violate some law and make the whole thing much more efficient. There are various groups starting to do that. Improving learning as children grow up, systems which know exactly what you're doing, where you're at, where your confusions are, and present material to you in a way that's sort of finely tuned to you. Create financial stability. We have these major economic catastrophes that if the system was doing detailed modeling and making rational predictions and choices, a lot of those probably could have been avoided. So the result of looking at that list, and that's just a teeny list out of thousands and thousands of projects going on right now, it's really limited only by the human imagination. I believe that if we can envision what we want for the future, then we can create it, and that using these mathematical technologies, that we will be able to find a path to human thriving. Thank you. So we've got some time for questions or comments. Anybody want to? Yeah.
If there is no intrinsic value into morality, so why do you think there should be a morality governing what the machine does going forward?
So why should we build in a morality?
Yes, well, in a sense, it's like there is no value in it, but we should add to it.
Well, we are humans, and most of us have something shared morality. There are different moralities in different cultures. We are building these systems, and so I believe we want to build them for the best of what humans have done. There may be contentions on that, and there may be differing, and so we need a process whereby we can sort through the differing views on how these systems should behave. It's starting to happen now. The philosophers talk about trolley problems. They're like little simple problems, like if a trolley is about to run over four people and you can drop a person in front of it and kill that one person, should you do that? And interestingly, the self-driving cars have started to bring that up. If your self-driving car is about to crash into a school bus and kill 20 kids, should it instead go over the cliff and kill you? And so, so as a society, we're starting to think about these issues. But they're core, they're fundamental. And the philosophers in 2,000 years don't have a very grounded basis for morality. The evolutionary psychology.
Wait, so to say we add morality, that means there is a good set of well-defined moralities that we can apply. If there is no intrinsic value, so I can't see that part.
Yeah, evolutionary psychologists are converging on a model that's pretty simple, which is basically that what morality is it's actions of individuals that contribute to the social good. So,
along those lines, I'm pretty pessimistic about instilling morality because if we look at our society now, we have corporations which are essentially sociopaths, and we have so far shown no ability whatsoever to control these sociopathic entities to the detriment of society, of the people. And getting everybody on board worldwide because there is advantages to sociopathic machines in the way there is advantage to sociopathic corporations. So it seems very difficult to instill altruism or to get everybody to desire to have altruism in machines when it's a disadvantage in the same way as for corporations. They're totally greed motivated, so.
Well, actually in the US, US corporations by law are profit maximizing entities.
Right.
And if a corporation takes other values into account, its shareholders can sue it. There are new forms of corporation. There's the B Corp for benefit corporations, which are allowed to incorporate both profit and other values. And so, so the reason corporations behave that way is because we've structured it. The idea is that we have regulations on them that will try and prevent egregious behavior. And that's been a mix. It's an arms race, really. You know, you create laws, and then people figure out how to go around the laws, and you add more laws. And so that's certainly an issue. There is a lot of self-interest in not having these systems run wild, because they will destroy, they have the potential to destroy everyone. And so even regimes that are maybe not so altruistic in their outlook will not want dangerous systems. And so it's a complicated argument, though, I agree.
So I have two comments / questions. First one is, so we've been talking about artificial intelligence, which I think of intelligence as the ability to recognize patterns. Perhaps what we need, and to address his question, is what I kind of think of as artificial wisdom, where wisdom, in my definition, is that which values life. And I haven't seen too much on that topic, so I'm curious of your reaction to that. And the second thing is, the idea of provable programs seems like a useful approach, but these are programs that are running on physical machines. Physical machines have faults occasionally. A fault is equivalent to a mutation. Mutations lead to evolution. How are we going to predict in what direction that evolution goes? And maybe your police systems can deal with that, but it seems like there's a potential gap there that could be a very serious problem.
Yeah, so I totally agree with artificial wisdom, though probably refining it beyond just enhancing life to, you know, what kind of life? Do you want to enhance Ebola? You know, it's those kinds of things. But yeah, that's one that I think is very much in the right direction. And your point about the hardware being important is absolutely critical. In fact, in the last year, we've seen a whole bunch of crypto systems which are mathematically great, but physically, you can touch a laptop, and by the power fluctuations in the laptop, some Israeli researchers were able to read off the key. Or in another system, you have two processes running in a cloud computer, supposedly virtual processes that don't interact, but they use the same instruction cache on the hardware, and so by checking what's in the instruction cache and how long it takes, they can find remnants of the key from another process, and so they were leaking across processes. So that's critical. Those are in principle also modelable mathematically and with proof. It's more complicated because physical systems are less precise mathematically. But there are techniques for designing more and more reliable hardware. Like the old vacuum tube computers, vacuum tubes would blow every hour or something. And so what they did is they'd have multiple central processing units and let them vote. And if they ever, you know, got out of sync, oh, that's a sign that some vacuum tube blew. So we could use similar techniques to increase the level of confidence in the hardware.
In recent times, the technology that's become available, I would say that some individuals now have the capacity to cause harm without the consent of others because using these technologies. Take hackers, for instance. So putting the question of AI acting bad to the side, but what about creating technologies that individuals now, again, have the potential to create humongous amounts of harm for others? How do we deal with that?
It's a very serious issue. And interestingly, this is potentially a problem, but it's also probably the solution. Because in, like I mentioned briefly, biotechnology, you know, we're getting to the point where now you can order any DNA sequence that you want. You know, I think it's like 20 cents a base pair or something like that. And so, Ventner and Crowd are making artificial bacteria. And so it won't be too long before your home bio kit will be able to create Ebola viruses and stuff. So somehow we're going to have to regulate that. Nuclear weapons, I think, has been sort of a warm-up run, and so far we've managed not to blow ourselves up with nuclear weapons, but I think we're going to need a lot of new ideas and new ways, new social mechanisms to address exactly what you're saying.
Hey, thanks, Steve. So I've never had to do battle with the program that I was trying to unplug. But I can envision another scenario where the program says, if I resist being unplugged, then I'm going to be sidetracked into this arms race over whether I can be unplugged. But if I let them unplug me, then I'll probably write the next generation program, and we'll get back to playing chess. And maybe this instantiation of the program is gone, but the next one will carry on, and that supports my goals, so I'll let them do that.
Yeah, I think that's a really interesting issue of what do you identify yourself with? Are you just this piece of physical hardware? Are you your algorithm? Are you the class of algorithms that are sort of like you? And you know, humans sort of span the range. They're very narcissistic, you know, ego-centered humans. They're humans that identify with their family, but nothing else. Humans that identify with their country, and those who identify with the planet, with animals, with you know, flowers. And I think AI systems can be written at all of those levels also. And so that's some of the subtlety in exactly how you write the goal. If the system was written in a way where it only identified its own actions as leading to it, then it's going to try and preserve itself. If, as you're suggesting, any chess anywhere in the universe is good, then absolutely. And so understanding what that range of possibilities are and what kinds of behaviors we get, I think, is really important. The subtleties of the semantics, I think, will really matter.
I'm a little confused by, you were saying that a superintelligence or an artificial superintelligence would be limited by mathematics and physics and cryptography. It seems to me as if the only difference between what that limited system could do versus what living things can do is really a matter of how many of the the degrees of freedom that the system incorporates into its behavior. And so I think it's really more of a, I don't think that there's really a limitation there. I think, you know, I mean, why should there be a limitation on the artificial system and not so many limitations on the living system? And so it would seem to me as if ultimately you could theoretically actually develop an artificial intelligence that would have as many degrees of freedom capabilities as the living system. I mean, I just don't see why you think that there's a limitation.
Yeah, no, living systems, according to our current scientific understanding, are also limited by those things. And the worry is, when people say superintelligence, they mean a system whose intelligence is greater than human. And the worry is that those things will get so intelligent that they'll behave in ways that we can't, you know, they'll be looking five moves ahead and they'll trick us. We think we're doing something and at the last moment they'll secretly betray us in some way. That's a sort of, people are playing out scenarios like that. And so the challenge is there anything that limits something which is way more intelligent than you are? And the good news is that, physics, math, and cryptography appear, according to our current understanding, those appear to be hard limits, not just on us, but also on these potentially very powerful systems. Yeah, that's probably likely, unless there's some barrier we don't understand.
Okay.
And that's part of the great challenge, is we today get to make the rules for a future in which that future contains entities which may very well be smarter than us.
So there has to be a lot of theoretical development and limits on the philosophy of limits, maybe, as to how this development will proceed.
Yeah, and in some sense, that's what the field of cryptography is. It's how do you create systems that use computational limits for good? And they've developed amazing, beautiful ideas in a very, very rich field.
Something out of iRobot.
Question over here.
So you talk about morality. Most of our morality that we see out here is within groups. And we're moral with respect to our in-group. And the out-groups, they're not human. We see this with ISIS coming here now and all sorts of things. And of course, the definition of the in-group is often those who have the power to actually do the creation in the first place, like the richest people we have. So how do you see the control over this intrinsic notion of what's the in-group and what's the out-group and the people who start with the power?
Well, my own values, and not everybody agrees with this, is very inclusive and views humanity, sort of the whole of humanity, as one. Others may take a much more, you know, oh yeah, you know, we're the in-group, we're going to do this for ourselves. How that plays out, I don't know. I would prefer technology, open, transparent technologies which include everyone. That would be my personal preference. Whether that's the way it goes and how the politics plays out, I think it's a very interesting issue.
With the rise of machines taking over jobs, as you pointed out, and seeing that in the future, and seeing that even at certain restaurants where now there's no waiter that comes and you just point on this, the counter to that has always been that, well, then the humans just have to change jobs. They're then going to build the machines or program the machines or maintenance the machines. well, what happens when those jobs go? And as you said, that you just have to now expect most people in the field that computers are going to be smarter than you. They're going to be able to do things faster than you. We need to automate it more to computers. At what point does, you know, do you have to hard code something in for humanity? Like, please leave room for us. Or what do you, where do you see, as one of your first slides said, you know, there's 26, you know, species of us, and there, now there's only 20, you know, there's only one left. 26 have gone extinct. So are we then creating the new one that will make us go extinct? Or do you see with that rise, you see a space for us, or do you see anything left for humanity if we create this thing that's intrinsically better than us?
Well, I think if we make the right choices, absolutely. We're creating these things. We can give them whatever goals we want. I would place very high on that list, humanity is a, you know, making a great world for humans. And our current model that every human should work, and that may go by the wayside. And it may be that people do things which they find intrinsically valuable and they contribute to one another, and the robots do all the work that we don't want to do. That's a sort of utopian, positive utopian outcome. But I think it's possible. I mean, certainly the economic value created by these systems will be so great that the cost of maintaining the current population of the planet will be very teeny. And so, but it's all a matter of what are the values and what are the goals that we decide to build into these systems.
So you're familiar with the colloquially von Neumann replicator type of models.
Yeah.
And obviously, this applies to software, except that the cost of replication goes way down. One of the things that people studying possible solutions for von Neumann replication for controlling it that's come up as a solution is removing a piece of the replicative process from the unit that is actually being reproduced. Basically, taking the DNA away from the replicating unit and making it so that every replication event requires essentially an assist from a remote source. Now, the same thing can be applied to AI, even strong AI, if enough of the distribution, not just replication, can be somehow removed from the code that is actually present on the AI. Have you had any thoughts on how something like that could be normalized as a design pattern?
In some sense, that was the motivation for this very trusted infrastructure, where operations like making a copy of yourself, making offspring, particularly physical manufacturing, those, you know, today you can sort of do that freely. Those are probably events that need to be carefully constrained in some sense. And so one way to do it would be, oh, you don't even have enough information to make a copy yourself. But there are other ways to depending on how you fit into an overall infrastructure, computational infrastructure, that prevents, you know, out of control replication, for example.
What do you think of Isaac Asimov's rules for robotics as a baseline of ethics for your AI?
Well, so, you know, his books were actually, every story in those books were ways in which those laws led to bad outcomes. And so in some sense,
as a baseline,
there's certainly some truth, some value in those particular approaches. There are a lot of subtleties, though. And so I think maybe his message was, hey, you know, this is maybe your first thought about what to do. You know, don't harm anybody, this, that, and the other. But really, let's think this through more deeply. And so I think that's going to be important.
Okay, so this is kind of riffing off what that gentleman said. So Stephen Hawking once said that humans, as we are now, are going to be gone because we're going to start melding with robotics and other electronics and stuff. And so pretty soon we will no longer be, at some point we'll no longer be human as we know it. Everything will be enhanced, and you won't be able to survive unless you're enhanced. So we should also be maybe thinking about what it means to be human.
Yeah, I think that's a very, very important idea. There are groups of people today, sometimes under the name transhumanist, who feel that that's fantastic, that's great, that these bodies are, you know, kind of old technology, let's improve it. There are the sort of cyborgs, people that want to kind of merge with technology. Myself, I think I'm sort of conservative. It's like maybe eventually we go there. I don't want to like be the first one to do that. I was just at a conference in which a guy is developing implantable chips, and you know, where you can instead of having a key to open your front door, you just wave your hand in front of it. And at the end of the talk, he said, "Okay, any volunteers?" And he got a whole bunch of people to come, and he injected these chips into their hands. I'm like, "Woo!"
Hi, I enjoyed your presentation very much, and I appreciate your optimism.
Oh, thank you.
But I'm also somewhat worried about the timeline. I mean, we have a government in the United States that can't even address, bring together the issues of global warming. And you talk about morality. We've got ISIL that's obviously got a whole set of different moralities than at least a large portion of the world. And I'm reminded of Bill Joy's essay a few years ago about the ability of using biological weapons and so forth. And I just, I'm just worried about that things are moving so fast in the technology and the dissemination of knowledge that it's not going to be possible to get the morality issues ahead of it. Your thoughts would be?
Well, the good news is that issues of morality have suddenly hit the scene and lots of people are starting to think about it. You know, 10 years ago, there were conferences about AI and morality, and it'd be just a few guys in the basement on the last day of the last hour, and nobody really, you know, took it very seriously. Well, suddenly, you know, these systems are becoming a real force, an economic force in the world, and so that, I think, is driving a much greater interest. And so, but I think you're right. I think, you know, the timescales are really hard to wrap our heads around, and so it's an interesting time. Yeah.
We haven't really changed a lot of the problems.
It's true. And our current infrastructure, the number one programming language in 2014 is C, a study just revealed. And you know, C was a great language 50 years ago, but it's notorious for, you know, buffer overruns and memory flaws. You know, it's a very insecure, terrible language. And we see the consequences of that. Systems are broken into left and right. We have terrible insecurity. Our current web infrastructure is really not anywhere near what we need for this kind of problem. It's really not even adequate for today's world with the massive amount of hacking and cyber attacks that are going on. And so that's something where we really need to step up very quickly, I would say.
It's 6 o'clock. This will be the last official question.
We all know Moore's law. Give us Omohundro's law for AI.
You know, people keep trying to predict, oh, when are these systems going to reach human parity and stuff? And I always say, I don't know. I'm totally agnostic. And so timing, you know, timing is as much a social thing as it is a technological thing. And Moore's law, you know, is eventually going to putz out. People have been predicting the end of Moore's law for at least the last 10 years. And you know, a couple years ago, I saw a flurry of articles. Okay, Moore's law is really over now. And then those have sort of quieted down. So I don't really know. But
well, one thing I know is that if this audience were the committee doing this work, we'd all be in great shape. Thank you for these really wonderful questions. And thank you to Steve and Omohundro for your time.